Good evening and welcome to all of you in the name of our gracious God, who is our courage, our strength, our salvation. In our lives as Christians, we have many reasons to be afraid. Many things happen that might shake our confidence. And yet in God's word today, we are reminded that we have a rock solid confidence in Jesus and no reason whatsoever to be afraid. We worship our Lord tonight by following the order of service as printed in the service folder. We will begin with the responsive call to worship. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. If you make the Most High your dwelling, even the Lord, who is my refuge. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen. Let us now continue by singing the opening hymn, I Walk in Danger All the Way. Please rise. Beloved in the Lord, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sin, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray that of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, as a called servant of the Word, announce the grace of God to all of you, and in the stead, and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we are to pray, and to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. In our first lesson, the Apostle James reminds us of the confidence we have, a confidence that is so great in Christ that we are even able to consider it a joy when we suffer for him. We read from James chapter 1. Consider it complete joy, my brothers, whenever you fall into various kinds of trials, because you know that the testing of your faith produces patient endurance. And let patient endurance finish its work, so that you may be mature and complete and lacking nothing. If any one of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives it to all without reservation and without finding fault, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, without doubting, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. In fact, that person should not expect that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Blessed is the man who endures a trial patiently, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God promised to those who love him. This is God's word. Let us now rejoice together in the grace of our God with the words of Psalm 73. The congregation will sing the refrain, and I will read the verses of the psalm. I am always with you, O Lord. You hold me by my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, and afterward you will take me into glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Please rise. The gospel today is recorded in Matthew chapter 14, beginning at verse 22, where we are reminded what it means to trust in the Lord Jesus. We read, "Immediately, Jesus urged the disciples to get into the boat and to go ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed the crowd, he went up onto the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. By then, the boat was quite a distance from shore, being pounded by the waves because the wind was against it. In the fourth watch of the night, Jesus came toward them walking on the sea. When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and cried out in fear, 'It's a ghost!' But Jesus spoke to them at once, saying, 'Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid.' Peter answered him and said, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water.' Jesus said, 'Come.' Peter stepped down from the boat, walked on the water, and went toward Jesus. But when he saw the strong wind, he was afraid. As he began to sink, he cried out, 'Lord, save me!' Immediately, Jesus stretched out his hand, took hold of him, and said to him, 'You of little faith, why did you doubt?' When they got into the boat, the wind stopped. Those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, 'Truly you are the Son of God.'" This is the gospel of our Lord. Let us now join together in faith to confess our faith by speaking the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We now continue by singing Jesus Savior, Pilot Me. You may be seated. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who stills all of our fears, because he has set us free forever. Amen. He had been traveling for 40 days. He had been traveling for 40 days and he was completely alone, or so he thought. Prior to that, he was running for his life, running from the northern area way up in the northern part of Israel, all the way down to the southern part of Israel, running because the queen of Israel, Jezebel, was focused, taking an oath to take his life, sending out the soldiers and the special force units to hunt him down like a criminal, to find him and to kill him, and he knew that they were after him, so he was running. And he collapsed, exhausted, under a tree. So exhausted, so alone, so distraught, so discouraged, that he prayed to the Lord that he would take his life. But the Lord didn't. Instead, he provided him water, he provided him food, he strengthened him so that now he could continue on this 40-day journey toward the region of Mount Horeb. And then when he arrived at the region of Mount Horeb, he went up into a cave to spend the night. Hunted down like a criminal, completely alone, with no one caring for him, or so he thought. He was the last prophet left by his own confession. He was hurting. He was grieving. He was afraid. He was terrified. But let's pause this evening now to listen to the encouragement that the Lord gave to his prophet Elijah, and built him up and encouraged him with a strength that comes only from God himself, because that is exactly the same encouragement our gracious Lord God whispers into our ear every time we listen to him, every time we cling to his promises, every time we find strength in him. We read about this event recorded in 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning at verse 9. He came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord suddenly came to him, saying, "Why are you here, Elijah?" He said, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of armies, but the people of Israel have abandoned your covenant. They have torn down your altars and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking to take my life." Then the Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is passing by." Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind came an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire, there was a soft, whispering voice. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak, and he went out and stood at the entrance to the cave. Then a voice came to him and said, "Why are you here, Elijah?" He said, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of armies, but the people of Israel have abandoned your covenant. They have torn down your altars and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking to take my life." Then The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came, and go to the wilderness of Damascus. When you get there, you are to anoint Hazael as king over Aram. You will also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel, and Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place. Whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, Jehu will kill. And whoever escapes the sword of Jehu, Elisha will kill. But I have preserved in Israel 7,000 whose knees have not bent to Baal and whose lips have not kissed him." This is God's word. Sometimes a whisper, a gentle whisper, can be louder than a shout. Sometimes a whisper can grab a person's attention more and say more than shouting it out loudly. There are times that it is appropriate to shout. If the little child is going off in a direction where he shouldn't be going, it's okay to shout out, "Stop!" and get their attention so they stop going that way. If we're driving down the road and we're in the passenger seat and the driver doesn't see the deer that is approaching, it's okay at that time to shout out, "Deer!" and get the attention so that there's not an accident. But sometimes that gentle whisper can really grab a person's attention. When a little child is hurting and a parent whispers in her ear words of comfort and encouragement, there's no comfort more powerful. When a student is wiggling in the classroom desk and a teacher just pauses quietly for a moment, looks at the student and whispers, that can work, and it can grab the attention and wake up that student and get him to finally settle down. This whisper, this soothing whisper from our God, was exactly what the prophet Elijah needed. As he whispered in Elijah's ear, he was reminding him of his love, his compassion. He was drying his tears of grief and offering him the building up that he needed. This gentle whisper spoken by the Lord built him up with power, the power that he needed to continue on as the Lord's prophet. And it wasn't just the tone or the volume of the whisper that made it powerful and encouraging. It was the content, the words, the soothing words of peace that spoke to the prophet, essentially saying to him, "I am your Savior. Don't give up. Don't be afraid. I am with you. I am blessing you." That gentle whisper of our God is spoken to each one of us every time we are listening to his word and hearing his word. And in the whisper of our God's gospel, he is encouraging us. He is driving out any fear we might have. He is removing any doubts that might be persistent. And he is building us up to remind us who we are by his grace because of what he has done for us. His whisper says it all. It all started at Mount Horeb with Elijah, when the Lord came to him with a question. It began with a question. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Why? Why do you think the Lord asked Elijah that question? He knew exactly why Elijah was there. He knew everything that Elijah had experienced. He knew the turmoil in Elijah's heart. He knew the fear that prompted him to run. He knew how physically, emotionally, and spiritually exhausted and drained he was. The Lord knew, and yet he asked him that question, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" The Lord wasn't asking him that question for the Lord's benefit. He had nothing to gain from that question. Elijah did. He was asking it for Elijah's benefit, to lead him to examine himself and to consider his God, to lead him to confess, to lead him to unload and give everything over to the Lord so that the Lord could bear his burden for him. And that's exactly what the question drove Elijah to do. And listen to the honesty of this prophet's confession. "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of armies. But the people of Israel have abandoned your covenant. They have torn down your altars. They have killed your prophets with the sword. I am the only one left. And they are seeking to take my life." What do we hear in Elijah's confession? What are we hearing? We are hearing frustration. "I have been zealous in serving you, but look at where I am now, alone." We hear frustration and discouragement. We hear sadness and grief. "They have killed my fellow prophets, my brothers in faith." We are hearing discouragement. "They have destroyed everything, including your altars." We are hearing loneliness. "I'm the only one left. I have no one to be with." And we are hearing fear. "Now they are trying to kill me too." Elijah needed help. Elijah was desperate. Elijah was hurting. This was a low point in his life, in his ministry. What is the low point in our lives? What is frustrating us right now? To the point that we might be throwing up our arms, maybe literally or figuratively. But throwing up our arms, "I can't believe this is happening. I don't know how much longer I can take it." What is driving us to worry and fear so that we're consumed by the fear to the point that we're having a hard time sleeping at night? Is there that time of loneliness when we become personally convinced no one can understand what I'm going through? I'm going through it alone. I am completely alone. Is there despair and sadness? Nobody seems to care. There is no love out there. I'm the only one left. There are those times that we join Elijah with this discouragement, this fear, this sadness, this grief, this loneliness. But the Lord approached his prophet in a unique, special way to meet him where he was at and to build him up and show love for him. Our God has done that for us. This gentle whisper of our God was whispered for Elijah, but not only for him, it is whispered for us. There are times that our God acts loudly. When he sent the rain and the storm for 40 days and 40 nights and covered the earth with a flood, that was a pretty loud demonstration of power. There are times that the Lord acts loudly. When the Lord gave his law at Mount Sinai, the thunder and the lightning crashed. And the earth trembled, and the entire mountain was covered in a billow of smoke. The Lord was acting loudly. But in this case, the Lord was making a dramatic comparison for his prophet. so that he would realize and know the soothing comfort of the gospel as the Lord was coming to him with his gentle heart and compassion. And the Lord did it, first of all, by coming loudly. It's interesting, the timing of this event, this discouragement for Elijah. It was only about 40 days earlier that Elijah experienced the loud glory of God revealed in a day of victory for the prophet. You might remember how Elijah was up there on Mount Carmel in the northern part of Israel, 400 prophets of Baal. And then Elijah built his altar out of stone, and the Lord crashed down fire in a boom and an explosion from heaven. So the altar went everywhere and smashed it and devastated it. And Elijah enjoyed victory that day over the prophets of Baal. And a day later, he was running for his life, sobbing, crying, terrified, exhausted, discouraged, and not knowing what was going to happen next. So now God was coming to him to rescue him. And to make the comparison between the loudness of the Lord's act of power and the soothing gentleness of the gospel, we are told in our text that first the Lord came in a violent wind. And the wind roared past the entrance of that cave. A wind more powerful than what hit Iowa 2 weeks ago. A wind that shattered the rocks and it broke the stones. But the Lord was not in that wind. Then the earth began to shake under the feet of Elijah, and the rumbling and the roar of the earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. Then the blazing fire that roared in front of him as he felt the heat and had to look the other direction because the fire was so bright. But the Lord was not in that fire. He was in the gentle whisper of his word. His word is what gave power, gave encouragement, and built him up. It lifted him up from his frustration. It encouraged him out of his discouragement. He reminded Elijah, "You are not alone, I am with you." And he reminded him that the word of God is having an impact. Because there are 7,000 in Israel who have not bowed down to Baal, but believe as you do, Elijah. And then the Lord made it clear to his prophet, "I'm going to be in control of every event in the government, even of the godless governments, and I'm going to make sure my will is done in this world, and I'm in control, not you, not the kings, not the people, not Israel attacking the word of God. God is." And Elijah, in a whisper, "Remember that and be built up as my redeemed child." Maybe there are those times that we feel like we're curled up in a cave at Mount Horeb, relating pretty well to what Elijah must have been going through. And that type of a discouragement can lead to sadness, and it can lead us to look a different direction from looking to our God. It can lead us to look at the things of this world and become frustrated. It can lead us to look inward and be reminded of our weakness, and that leads to despair. It can lead us to look at what we have or don't have, and that can lead to a feeling of isolation or a lack of contentment. Either way, all of those problems lead us away from looking at where we need to be looking, to our God in his word. But it's when we are the lowest, when we are hurting the worst, that the gentle whisper of our God spoken in our ear speaks the loudest and is the most comforting and the most powerful. Because your God in his word is reminding you, "I am your Savior." Our God speaks to us in a gentle whisper, reminding, "Listen, I took your burden upon myself. Don't try to carry it yourself. I washed it away with my blood." The gentle whisper of our God draws us to see the cross that he bore for us and the sin and guilt that he washed away, and the death that he removed so that it is replaced by life. Our God comes to us as we hear his word, which is power. If we find ourselves worrying, doubting, becoming frustrated, struggling with loneliness, doubting and wondering about so many things, then pause and listen to your God. He hasn't stopped talking to us. His word is eternal, and he's given it to us for a reason, so that we might hear it, listen to it, and believe it. And when we do, we are reminded that there is nothing that can defeat the child of God, because God is almighty and perfect in love. When we listen to the gentle whisper, we are reminded that there is nothing really that should cause us to be afraid or worry, because he's carrying us and he is the one in control. And it's when we look to our God that the attitude talked about by James, that seems so difficult to have. Consider it pure joy, my brothers, when you experience trials. The pure joy comes by looking to the Lord who is taking care of us, and everything that he permits or brings is according to his good plan, and he knows more about what is better for us than we do. His gentle whisper reminds us of that. Elijah, a wonderful example of faith, a beautiful believer, a faithful prophet. But what made him a wonderful believer and an example of faithfulness was not because he was without shortcomings and imperfections. Every single one of us, with our frailties, our weaknesses, our hurts, our sins, and our guilt, are elevated by God to belong to him as righteous, made righteous by him. And it's because our God is good, because Jesus is our Savior, and because he died and now lives. That's his love that he whispers in our ear. Listen to that whisper. It says it all. Amen. Now the peace of our God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, the heavens declare your glory, and the creation shows your beautiful handiwork. Day after day they speak of you, and night after night they display your wonders. There is nowhere that we can go where they are not heard, where your word is sweeter than any of these. Your words speak to us, and they speak forgiveness. They promise eternal life and salvation. Though in weakness we sin again and again, yet you are always faithful to your word and forgive our sins. Grant that we may find comfort again this evening in your faithful love. Draw near to all repentant sinners and speak your comforting words this very night. Be also with our dear ones and those we love here and everywhere, and bless them, keeping them in your care. When in the night I sleepless lie, my soul with heavenly thoughts supply. Let no ill dreams disturb my rest, no powers of darkness me molest. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. You may be seated. Let us close our worship by singing the closing hymn, Jesus, Lead Us On. Good evening again, and welcome to each and every one of you. It's good to see you again as we gather together to worship our gracious God. Please read through the announcements in the bulletin. You'll notice that this Sunday at the 10:30 service, we will be installing three teachers into their respective areas of ministry at Christ St. John's Lutheran School. That is a big event, and we're very thankful for that. Also, take the time to read through the announcements and check out the calendars and everything that we have going on. Please continue to pray that we keep on proclaiming the Word of God and reaching out to as many people as possible. Also take note of when we will have Bible study. Our Sunday morning Bible study is live streamed if you're not here, so you are able to watch it online and grow together with us in the Word of God. Please also take the time to greet one another as it is appropriate, and I'll be wandering around outside and greet you outside.